Monty, I was speaking up in Yarnell last week. I think Monty actually said something about that. And we prayed for also the pastor at Congress, Tim, that was in the hospital in Tucson on a ventilator, and he got off of that on Monday right away. So we're just thankful for that. Obviously, others are still suffering. There's a lot of people going through some hard times, and we want to continue to pray for them as well. But we can certainly rejoice with that at the same time. All right. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to ask you to do one more thing in just a second. Are you going to do a little talk first again when you have people stand up? Or?
Sure. After prayer.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, I don't want to make them stand up too early.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, because they get tired.
I know. That's why I'm sitting down.
That's why you're sitting down.
I'm already tired.
Okay, Devin, I want you to do one thing for me when we do stand up here in a few minutes.
Okay.
I want you to go to the wide view, and everybody stand up and wave at the cameras, so we can say hello to all the folks that are not here. Okay.
Gotcha.
Got it?
Gotcha.
All right. Yeah. Very good. What's that?
It's not quite.
Well, I know everybody won't be in it by any means, but. We'll do the best we can. We'll give it a try. Okay. All right, let's pray together. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness and grace to us, and we thank you, Lord, for blessing us as you have with our being able to meet together today in this place that you've given us, this building, and the resources to be able to share as well on the internet and with our folks that are not with us today. We do pray for them. We pray, Lord, that you would encourage them. We pray, Lord, that they would not feel isolated from us, but that we would be able to help them to make it through this time, while they're suffering with not the virus itself, but with the side effects of our being broken apart in the way we are. Lord, we know the church is built around the need for each other as well. That iron sharpens iron as flesh sharpens flesh as well. And Lord, that is important to us. We love everyone that is not here as well as those that are actively here right now. And so we pray that you would give them a special measure of your grace and the peace that passes all understanding. We thank you for and rejoice along with the family of Tim and Congress and that church as he's getting better. We think of Joe, who is improving as well from our congregation, and for the others that have been through it and back out again, and for the other things that are going on, others that are struggling with other things that are all involved in this. We just commit them to you. Thank you for the music and for what you're going to do as we share the rest of this service together this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right.
So everybody go ahead and stand and turn around.
Yeah, and just everybody that's here.
And wave.
Wave. We miss you.
We miss you.
Hello, everybody.
Highest King would welcome me. I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Ooh, the sun sets free. Oh, he's free. I'm a child of God, yes I am.
At last he has ransomed me, his grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died.
Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I'm chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Together, strangers, neighbors, our blood is one. Children of generations, of every nation, of kingdom come. So don't let your heart be troubled. Hold your head up high, no fear, no evil. Fix your eyes on this one truth. God is madly in love with you. So take courage, hold on, be strong. Remember where our help comes from. Whoa, whoa. Whoa. let the praise go up as the walls come down. All creation, everything with breath, repeat the sound. All his children, clean hands, pure hearts, good grace, good God. His name is Jesus. Sing Swing Wide.
Swing wide, all you heavens, let the praise go up as the walls come down. All creation, everything with breath, repeat the sound. All his children, clean hands, pure hearts, good grace, good God. His name is Jesus.
Whoa, 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 whoa. Yeah, I was counting.
That made it better. Huh? Made it better. Less awkward with the counting. Yeah. Good.
Lost to save, find their way at the sound. Of your great name, all condemned, peace or shame, at the sound of your great name, and every fear has no place at the sound. Your great name, the enemy, he has to leave at the sound of your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name.
All the weak find their strength at the sound of your
Redeemer. the Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name.
We'll sing that again.
We worship you this morning. We thank you for guiding us, directing us, Lord God. And it's because of your sacrifice that we can be here today, that we can be right with you. We can be right with you and God because of you. And we just we lift you up and we continue to worship you. And also, not just in song, but Lord, as this time that we have to learn from your word. So we pray that you would speak to us. Holy Spirit, we pray that we would acknowledge you. And we just pray that you would bring a new facet to us today through your word. It's in your Son's name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Joe. And our music folks. You know, sometimes you'll see me fiddling with this thing during the, when we're trying to talk. These things, most of you probably have never worn one before. They're kind of weird, to say the least. I was noticing, Devin, how many of you watched the Hamilton they have on TV now or in some of the broadcasts and so forth? What they do in on Broadway now is that they have a microphone, and it's right here. So I figure if I wear a wig, I could have one right here too, couldn't I? Wouldn't that work? So those people that are on Broadway now don't have to sing as loud as they used to and everything, because everybody's mic'd now. Do you use stuff like that out here too? Yeah. So that's what I want, is something like that that'll still work with bald. Just what? Tape. Thanks. That's good to have. Good to have friends like that. Recommend. Yeah. We have. In a little bit, we're going to be looking into James. So if you want to find your way to James chapter 4, that is where we're going to head here in just a little bit. I've got a comic for you here to start with this morning, as I usually do. And as long as everything works back there, Amy's going to find. There it is. Okay. This is actually from a week ago with the Wizard of Id. And he says, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, Happy New Year. And his wife says, what are you doing? It's July 26th. And he says, I just decided I was done with this year and ready to start a new one. And she decides to celebrate with him then. That's kind of the way we feel about a lot of this right now. It just seems like this keeps dragging on. And some things keep getting weirder and worser. I'll do that for Monty's sake. I'll say worser. And one of the things that I have observed, and I'm looking at it from not only within our local congregation, but also across the board, across the society in general, across the churches in general, that this is a time that is causing more and more division. Division is something that God does not want in the church. And so what we're going to talk about today is your little paper that you have in your bulletin there. It says, what divides us? This has to do with that question, what divides us? Well, I did a little bit of research, and I came up with something that's kind of interesting here. There are three wars that you probably have never heard of before. But I'm going to share with you a little bit about it. Have you ever heard of the War of the Whiskers? Some of you later on will have to look this up. You can find it on the internet. You can find some stuff about this. The War of the Whiskers took place in France between England and France in 1152. That's why none was remembered exactly. 1152, bearded King Louis VII married Eleanor, the daughter of a French duke, by which he received a dowry of two provinces. After his return from the Crusades, King Louis shaved his beard, which prompted Eleanor to declare that he was ugly without his beard. Eleanor demanded that he grow it back. When he refused, she divorced him and married King Henry II of England. She demanded the return of her dowry. When King Louis refused, King Henry declared war to recover the two provinces. The war lasted 301 years. And peace was finally declared only at the Battle of Rouen in 1453. Over whiskers. How about that? How about the War of the Oaken Bucket? This occurred in Italy in 1325 between the state of Bologna and the state of Modena. Soldiers from Modena invaded Bologna and stole a brown oak bucket. Hundreds of Bologna citizens were killed, and Bologna went to war to recover the bucket and their honor. After a bloody 12-year war in which thousands died, Modena won the Battle of Zappolino and kept the bucket, which can be seen in the bell tower of the 14th century building in Modena. And then there's the War of Jenkins' Ear. It took place between England and Spain in Europe and in the Atlantic Ocean. In 1731, Captain Robert Jenkins' ship was stopped and searched outside of Havana. During the encounter, the Spanish commander cut off Jenkins' ear. Returning to London, Jenkins appeared before the king and showed the severed ear in a case. No further action was taken then. However, the incident was raised again 7 years later in the House of Commons, and Jenkins' ear was passed around for all to see. Tempers soared, and Jenkins was declared a martyr. Ostensibly, Jenkins' ear was the reason England went to war with Spain, but more likely it was because England wanted to take over the West Indies. The ensuing war merged with the Austrian succession in 1740 to 1748, pitted England and Austria against Spain and Prussia. The result of the war left England with naval superiority. Spain lost very little on land. Jenkins became a supervisor of the East India Company. Started over that one situation where somebody's ear got cut off. There have been a lot of ridiculous wars and a lot of ridiculous divisions and fights over the centuries. I'm sure there are many more that you could go to and find if you wanted to take the time to look it up. But my question this morning is, what divides us? What is it that makes a difference in the church? What is it that will split us apart? What is it that can make it so that we do not get along as God intended? In fact, I want to take you first to John chapter 17, verses 20 through 23. And I got another little quick comic in there, so stick that up first, if you would, Amy. Ah, there we go. This one here, I really like this. The church unity workshop has been postponed until the deacons can agree on the date, the time, and the color of the participants' name tags. Churches have split over less. In fact, I shared this up at Yarnell last week. Somebody said, yeah, I was in a church once where they split over the color of the carpet. So it does happen. We've heard stories. Maybe you've run across it before. We find ways to split things up. Well, Jesus' prayer is in John chapter 17. We often refer to it as the high priestly prayer. This is really technically, we call the other one the Lord's Prayer, but actually that's a prayer for the disciples were learning. But Jesus' prayer, the Lord prayed, is found in John chapter 17 and basically the whole chapter. But I want to read for you part of it, verses 20 through 23. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message. So that actually includes us. I don't know if you knew that, but Jesus prayed for us 2,000 years ago. That all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. In them and in you, I am in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. How important is unity? It is at the very core of the testimony that the church has to the world. The world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. It is a pretty big deal when there's division among God's people. So what I want to do is take you on a little trip through a couple of other passages of Scripture first this morning in the New Testament and talk about some of these things and point out some of the things that divide us. This is one of those deals where the idea is not to, it's really hard sometimes to preach a message out of something that's so specifically stated in the Scriptures without saying, this is to make you feel guilty. It's not to make you feel guilty. The Bible is we speak of it sometimes as the mirror of the Word. The idea is that we're supposed to look at it and say, ooh, I better work on that. Ooh, maybe I better repent of that. But it's not to just make you say, oh, I feel guilty and I'm going to walk out of the church now. I'm going to feel guilty all the time now because I was not doing it right and there's no way I can really do it right. The idea is to have a look at what God's intentions are and what you should really be aiming at and then to strive for it. And that's one of the important things here that Jesus is praying. He's prayed for the disciples that they would be this way. But why did he have to do that? Think about it just a second. It doesn't come naturally. It has to come supernaturally. It has to come with some effort. In other words, you and I will not just, most of us at least, will not automatically gravitate towards unity. We're going to disagree about things. We're going to disagree about stuff that really matters sometimes. Like one of the reasons that we have the Sunday school class, why we go through the book of John, whether it's preaching on Sunday morning or whatever, is because theology is important. And whether or not you think you like to study theology or not, every single one of us has a theology. You either believe biblically or you believe in some other way a view of God. The theology is a study of God and getting to know Him. Well, you've got some kind of theology. Even an atheist has a theology. Their theology is that they believe that there is no God. So all of us have theology. We can disagree about that sometimes. There are certain fundamental things that we cannot disagree about and really be in fellowship, like somebody who doesn't believe in the deity of Christ, for instance. That does not fit with what the Scriptures say and does not fit with us. But if you believe theologically that the second coming is preceded by the rapture, or if it's during the middle of the tribulation, or those things are not things that should cause division, even though sometimes they do. Whether or not we are to raise our hands when we praise God, or bow our heads, or kneel, or whatever, those things have split churches before and split people up before, but they shouldn't. You know, I was raised American Baptist, and back in those days, 60 years ago and so forth, you didn't raise your hands in church unless you were Assembly of God or one of the Pentecostal groups. Then I went on to be a Presbyterian. You not only didn't raise your hands, you probably kept them in your pockets because you didn't want to have any chance that you accidentally would raise your hands, you know, and like express yourself in some way. I mean, we find all kinds of things that are cultural and a lot of times they're personal. That some people are more demonstrative, some people are more emotional in these things. Some people, you know, with the things that divide us can be so silly sometimes, and we have a lot of times just got to agree to disagree and move on. Let's take a little look through a couple of passages of Scripture. I want to go first to Luke chapter 9, verses 46 through 48. I'm going to read them for you or share them with you, but the first question is, what divided the early disciples? The question was, is who's going to be first? Who's going to be sitting at the right hand of Jesus? Who's going to be the first apostle? Who's going to be the lead guy in Jesus' kingdom? This is actually taking place, by the way. The I believe it actually kind of rounded about twice in the life of Jesus with the disciples. When Jesus has just told them that he's going to go to the cross, they start discussing, arguing about who's the greatest among them, among the disciples. An argument started among them as to which of them might be the greatest. But Jesus, knowing what they were thinking in their heart, took a child and stood him by his side and said to them, "Whoever receives this child in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives him who sent me. For the one who is least among all of you, this is the one who is the greatest." I don't know whether you what kind of view you have about the persons, Tyson and me as elders in the church, or the others that are deacons or whatever. If you think it is an honor, it is to a point. After that, it's a burden. After that, it's a huge responsibility. And if you aspire to be one of those leaders in the church, that's wonderful if God is calling you to do it. But let me tell you, don't aspire to be that if you're not called to be that. Those of you that have already been through that particular ringer at different times in the past know what we're talking about. The person who wants to be a pastor better know that he's called to be a pastor. Because those things invite attack and controversy and pain so often. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. Who wins? Now, this passage you might be familiar with a little bit is Paul is talking to the Corinthian church, and he goes through and he identifies a very interesting problem that they were having in the church. Does one among you, when he has a case against his brother, dare to go to law before the unrighteous and not before the saints? Or do you not know that the saints will judge the world? If the world is judged by you, are you not competent to constitute the smallest law courts? Do you not know that we will judge angels? How much more matters of this life? So if you have law courts dealing with the matters of life, do you appoint them as judges who are of no account in the church? I say this to your shame. It is so that there is not among you one wise man who will be able to decide between his brethren. But a brother goes against a brother-in-law, and that before unbelievers. Actually, then, it is already a defeat for you that you have lawsuits with one another. Why not rather be wronged? Why not rather be defrauded? On the contrary, yourselves wrong and defraud. So do this even to your brother. You see, in the Corinthian church, and unfortunately, even in the modern-day church, sometimes people are suing one another. Sometimes that's even over things that in the church. I try to keep up with stuff like that. It is very saddening at times to read what divides people. Paul is saying there are people that are wise in the church. Some of you are wise enough to be a judge between two people in the church that might have a disagreement. And he's saying this divides. When you always, and what he goes on down to say in verse 7, it's already a defeat for you that you even have a lawsuit, that you even have this. He says, why not rather be wronged? So often we don't want to give up our rights. We don't want to give up that we're correct, that we're right. Even if you're right, sometimes it's better for the church to back off and say, I'm not going any further with this. If you're going to fight over something, make sure it's important, something eternal. I entitled this line, Who Is Who Knows What? Because if you read in Philippians chapter 4, where Paul is writing to the Philippian church, he says, I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to live in harmony in the Lord. Indeed, true companion, I ask you also to help these women who have shared my struggle in the cause of the gospel, together with Clement also and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life. Now, this actually does not tell what was going on. But I have been a pastor for and in ministry for a long time. And let me tell you what goes on between two women in the church sometimes. You cannot put that in that cabinet in the kitchen. It goes in this cabinet over here. That you cannot use this tablecloth today because it's the wrong color. We have to have a blue one today. You want flowers? We can't have that kind of flowers. And there are things that have split godly women up. And I'm picking on the women in particular right now just because that's the passage itself. But because the men were the ones that were doing the lawsuits in the previous passage. It wasn't the women. In this one, it's the women in their division. They're breaking apart things. And we don't know why Euodia and Syntyche, but why they were split. But can you imagine? Your name ends up in Scripture. And it's because you couldn't get along with the other person. It's just... there are things that if we do not stop them from dividing us, they will divide us. If we don't say, if we don't take, when there starts to be that conflict, we have to step back and say, wait a second, this is going the wrong way. This is going to cause problems. James chapter 2, verses 1 through 9. My brethren, do not hold your faith in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ with an attitude of personal favoritism. For a man comes into your assembly with a gold ring and dressed in fine clothes. There also comes a poor man in dirty clothes, and you pay a special attention to the one who is wearing the fine clothes and say, you sit here in a good place, and you say to the poor man, you stand over there or sit down by my footstool. Have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil motives? Listen, my beloved brethren, did not God choose the poor of this world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom which he promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor man. Is it not the rich who oppress and personally drag you into court? Do they not blaspheme the fair name by which you have been called? If, however, you are fulfilling the royal law according to the Scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing well. But if you show partiality, you are committing sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. Now, what James was honing in on here in particular was that it was a custom of the day. It was the culture that they were in, that the person who was wealthy got special seating, got special place, and so on. And we don't have that problem, in a sense, in that same way here. But how do you treat people that make you uncomfortable? How do you treat people that come in to visit that maybe you would not necessarily spend a lot of time with? Because what he is saying is that we're supposed to love them anyway. They may not be on the same social status as us. They may not, believe it or not, they might even disagree with us on politics. Does that mean that we in some way are supposed to separate ourselves from them? Or treat them in a different way? You see, we can be fellows, we can be believers, we can be fellows of the same family of Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ, and still disagree about these things. We can still have disagreements that do not have to split us and divide us. And one of the important things for us to remember is that we both answer to the same master. And maybe he or she is wrong, but they've got to answer to Jesus Christ about that themselves. They don't have to answer to me. I'm not the judge. So who's really behind the divisions? What is behind the divisions? In James chapter 4, verses 1 through 6, and that's where we're going to camp for the remaining of this time. So find yourself to the book of James and verses 1 through 6 of chapter 4. And it's right after the book of Hebrews. And I took my paper out and lost my place there earlier. So James chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. And he goes through this little list of things, verses 1 through 6, that tell the desires of that kind of cause people to split and people to not stay in unity. And so if you'll follow along with me, we'll just do it a verse at a time here, because there's a quick, short list here. The first of them is in verse 1, where he says, "What is the source of quarrels and conflicts among you is not the source your pleasures that wage war in your members. You lust and you do not have, so you commit murder. And you are envious and cannot obtain, so you fight and quarrel. You do not have because you do not ask." The first main subject that he brings up is actually verses 1 and 2, is this whole problem of our own personal desires. We all have them, and in our Western culture, if you study cultural differences, you'll find out that a good bit of the world, especially the Far East and all, is in a culture where the group is the more important. That's why the Japanese, for instance, could throw thousands of soldiers as kind of like almost cannon fodder at us in the Second World War, because it was an honor to die as a part of that group, even if you never really accomplished anything. The idea was that the group is more important than the individual. We are very individualistic thinking people, especially in the United States, but in all of Western society. And we want what we want, because you deserve a break today, and you can have it your way. And you know, you deserve a certain kind of car. Need to have the best coffee. You know, we advertise that way. We push people towards it all the time. It is a very me society. We even in having a church service, we always try to think in terms of the individual, and we try to where they're going to be comfortable or not, and that kind of stuff. And it is built into us, into our thinking. And there's not anything necessarily wrong with that, except that sometimes it means that we get selfish. And I want my way, and I want it now. I think that a lot of times we forget that there is other people involved. And what it causes is sometimes that we get judgmental of others who don't agree with us and don't want our way. You know, so many people these days are so judgmental, and I can tell just by looking at them. Think about that a second. It'll catch up with you. I actually stole that quote from somebody else. But the idea is that we have the wrong motives for what we ask for. And he says the point is that you're supposed to go, you need to have the right motives. Why do you want what you want, and why do you want it now? You do not have because you do not ask, he says, and you ask and you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, so that you may spend it on your pleasures. We're supposed to go to God and ask that our needs be met, but what is our motivation? Our evil desires start to cause division. In verse 4, we find out he says this, and James is very harsh in some of his wording. He says, "You adulteresses, do you not know that the friendship with the world is hostility toward God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God." Part of the problem is that The Western society has really made us comfortable. You know, people that I've met that were in Honduras or in Thailand, where we've been, there was Benita had some experience, more experience of this in one of her trips there in Thailand. And this lady, they were trying to help her fix up her house, which was built across over an open sewage ditch. And that particular kind of a problem is not something you and I would very easily tolerate at all. She lives there. That's her home. Open sewage underneath of her, going by, the rats crawling in and out of the house all the time. That's one of the things they were trying to fix, it, kind of try and block that thing off. And we have our homes, and we have our comforts, and we have our certain mattresses, and we have air conditioning, thank God, at this time. Especially, you should thank God every day that you have air conditioning right now. In your car and in your home as well, in the store when you go to it or whatever. But we can get so caught up in being friends with this world that we don't even necessarily think that heaven's going to be better. We kind of don't long for heaven. Can you imagine somebody that's a believer that lives in above a sewage ditch might be longing for heaven? Somebody that is in a war-torn country where Christians are being killed all the time, or they're concerned about the Boko Haram in Nigeria, or with one of these other terrorist groups stealing their kids or taking things from them or taking their lives. They're not very attached to this world. We're pretty attached. I mean, there's a lot of good things about the way we live for the most part. And we can get so caught up in that friendship with the world and having what we wanted, having it right now. I mean, how many of you in recent times have gotten mad at your phone because you didn't get an answer in about 3 seconds after you punched in something for Google search? I mean, it's like, this is taking so long. When I first got my first desktop computer that I could do Bible study stuff on it, I would put in a verse search and it would take 5 minutes to come up with the verse, because it would search the whole Bible and find that one verse for me. Now I'm upset if I can't click on it and it doesn't pop up, because we are so stuck with the things in the world. But the question is are you friends with it to the point where you don't even care? I mean, like, God, I'm not ready to die yet, because I really don't. Heaven's like, okay, it looks all right. I hear nice, Monty gave great descriptions of it and so forth, but it's really not that bad here. And I think one of the things that may be happening in us in the church in the West right now is that we're starting to see that this world's not all that great. It's falling apart around us. It's getting more scary at times. There was an event in Portland Friday night, late at night. Protests have been going on and so forth. They burned a flag and a Bible. Interestingly, the people that stepped in and stomped it out were some of the other protesters. The protest may have crossed the line, finally, to the point where somebody said, wait a second. You're going, well, just a little bit too far. Burning a Bible? What's that got to do with any of this? Who is more important? What is more important? Are we friends with the world? Verse 6, but he gives a greater grace. Therefore it says, God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. I'm very humble and I'm proud of it. That's the way a lot of us, I mean, some people come across that way, you know. I'm humble and I'm proud of it, you know. Some of those sports guys, you wonder once in a while, it's like, pride can separate you, and it can also divide the church. It can divide Christians. It can separate us apart, because we're going to be right. And let me get really close to the toes here for just a moment. We have been fed so much information since February, especially, about what's right with this virus thing, about what's right with masks, about what's right with going to the hospital and taking care of things, what's right with even the treatments. There's big controversy about the treatments. There's this one thing that the president's talked about, and others are saying, oh, that absolutely won't work, and they're fighting back and forth about that. And they found out at one point that they needed to put people on respirators. Oh, but actually people that were not put on respirators were actually doing slightly better. So now what do we do? Oh, but we really need the rest. And they kept going back and forth, and there's all of this discussion, and we get on social media. Some of you are on there. You have some discussions on it. You have fights on it. You have wars on it sometimes. I mean, we don't want to be the one that's wrong. We want to take a side maybe, and we have a position, and we have a pride issue now because, wow, somebody disagreed with me. And I pretty much stay off of the social media because I just don't handle it very well, that kind of thing. But you really have to ask yourself, when somebody disagrees with you about mask or no mask or whatever it is that you're on, is it a matter of pride? Because guess what? It isn't in here. The masks are not in here. They're not spoken of. There's no place that it specifically says anything about that. And we live in a world with a lot of opinions and a lot of people that are telling their opinions, and we don't know what is being fed to us that's to control us. We don't know what's being fed to us that's wrong. The opinions keep changing, the statistics keep changing, and all kinds of things. So are we going to let those things divide us? Because guess who wants us divided? If Jesus is praying that the church be unified and that believers get along in unity, guess who's wanting us to be divided? And everything that comes along that we let divide us, and we don't try to stop the division, causes that prayer to not be answered, causes that unity that Jesus prayed for to go by the wayside. And it's a real big concern, because I'm afraid that when we come out of this, whatever that's going to look like someday, we're going to be divided. We're not going to be able to go on. There's statistics right now say that a third of the people that were attending church before the coronavirus started are not going back. A third. Now, there's a variety of reasons, but if it's because of division, it's not biblical. It's not from God. In verse 7, what's the solution? See, he gives solutions too. He didn't just list these out. Now, there's a whole lot of other things that could be dividing and so on, but what's the solution? Verse 7, he says, submit therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Number one of those solutions is submit therefore to God. Are you submitting? Ask yourself, in these things and in these divisions, are you first and foremost submitting to Jesus Christ? Pull your feet back, pull your toes in. I have to. Are we submitting to Jesus Christ first and foremost when we get into those discussions, those arguments, those divisions? Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Now, we all know that verse. We kind of get the idea we have to resist. But do you see that it's our responsibility to resist? It's not just going to be taken away from you without any pain. It is something you have to. This is you're part of the battle. This is your part of the war. You have to resist the devil. And then he's going to flee from you just because you resisted him. Verse 8, the positive side. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Now, the idea is that we make that effort to actually go towards God, and that will create the cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded part. be miserable and mourn, he says in verse 9, and weep, and let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. In other words, that you really show, you really show humility before God. You don't have to show it before everybody else in the world necessarily, but you're going to show it before God, because if you just always have it your way and you're just not drawing near to God, and if you draw near to Him, you're going to feel that need to repent at times. I don't know if any of you have ever read David Brainerd, his stuff from the 1700s. He was a very famous missionary that was one of the first ones to reach Native Americans in the United States. And he said, in my morning devotions, this was October 18th of 17 something or other, he says, in my morning devotions, early 1700s, my soul was exceedingly melted, and I bitterly mourned over my exceeding sinfulness and vileness. I never before had felt so pungent and deep a sense of the odious nature of sin as at this time. My soul was then unusually carried forth in love to God, and had a lively sense of God's love to me. And this love and hope at that time cast out fear. Both morning and evening I spent some time in self-examination to find the truth of grace, as also my fitness to approach God at His table the next day. And through infinite grace found the Holy Spirit influencing my soul with love to God as a witness within myself. This man was one of the, he died in his early 30s. He learned a language of one of the tribal groups in the Northeast and maybe a couple of languages, and he translated some scriptures for them, and he reached them with the gospel of Jesus Christ, and he was very effective, and he saw himself for what he really was, but he was in joy that Jesus, that God had given him that deliverance. Are you humble before Him and thanking God that He's made it possible for you for salvation, or are you saying to God, Lord, You really did deserve me. I'm a gift to You, you know. In Galatians chapter 6, verses 1 and 2, and we'll have to slide along quickly here. Brethren, even if anyone is caught in a trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of gentleness, each one looking to yourself so that you too will not be tempted. Bear one another's burdens and therefore fulfill the law of Christ. And he's talking here about what needs to be done among us is when we have that division, humbly work towards restoration. We used to say, with your hat in your hand to go to somebody. The idea is that you're apologetic, that you're humbled. And that is a recurring idea in the New Testament, that we humble ourselves if we try to help somebody that's really stumbling or off in a different direction. I mean, even if you disagree with them on one of these political things or whatever, that you still be humble about it. In 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 7 and 8, at the end of all things, Peter said this 2,000 years ago, if the end of all things is near, therefore be of sound judgment and sober spirit for the purpose of prayer. Above all, keep fervent in your love for one another, because love covers a multitude of sins. Do you have a fervent love for others? It's not just love, but it's a intense, it's a desire, it's a something you work at. Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 through 5, don't judge. Do not judge so that you will not be judged. For in the way you judge, you will also be judged. And by your standards of measure will be measured to you. Don't try to take the speck out of somebody's eye if there's a log in yours, he says. And this is important, that you do not judge somebody else's motives for their difference of opinion with you. It's real easy to have differences of opinion because we come from a different background, we're different people. But judging means you say, you're that way because you're stupid. You're that way because you want me to die. You're that way because whatever. And you ascribe a judgment to them, not just that we disagree. And Jesus says, judge others like that. you're going to be judged the same way. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 3. Being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. If you don't take anything else from this today, take these marching orders. Be diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Are you working at it? 2 commands come to mind. The only ones that are always there, the ones that we should always remember, are what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 22, verses 36 and 4 through 40. They said, "Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law?" And he said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and foremost commandment. The second is like this: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commands depend the whole law and prophets." Everything in the Ten Commandments, everything that's taught in the Scripture about how to treat others, everything in the Scriptures about relating to God is all in those two commandments. Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. If you love others as yourself, you're not going to have the divisions that are so easy to come up with in this world today. It's our privilege today to take a few moments to reflect and to go to the Lord with the table today and thank Him for what He's done and this remembrance. The night in which He was betrayed, He took bread, He broke it, passed it among His disciples and said to them, "This is my body broken for you. This is the blood of the new covenant given for you, poured out for you." We're going to share that now. Those of you at home, I should have said something to you a little bit earlier, but anyway, hopefully you have something there that you can share with us in this little bit of time of remembrance. Thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do in and through us this week. How, Lord, you're going to help us to bring unity to not only those among us, our own church people, but also the churches around us, those that follow Jesus Christ and claim that name. And Lord, that unity will also spread, we know, even into society as we mirror and portray the love of Jesus Christ to them. Lord, help us to love you as we should and to love our neighbors as ourselves as we should too. Please bless this as we share the blessing together. In Jesus' name we pray.
I take the bread of life.
bread of life, broken for us. He died for us so that we might have eternal life. He took upon himself the punishment for our sin. In remembrance, let's eat together. From the very beginning, covenant was based on a blood sacrifice. The ultimate blood sacrifice had to be the Lord Jesus Christ. To end all sacrifices, he poured out his blood for us. Let's drink in remembrance of him. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord. We ask your blessing upon our going today. Lord, may we go seeking to bring unity in the church and being the light and salt in the world, also bring that unity to our community, to our state, even to the national level. We honor you, Lord, with that going and pray that you would bless us and keep us until we can meet together again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.